यूनिट वन चैप्टर नंबर थ्री वाटरशेड एरिया एंड वाटर टाइप्स। नाउ व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय वाटरशेड एरिया? नाउ वी नो द रिवर वाटर फ्लोज नेचुरली फ्रॉम वन प्लेस टू अनदर, ओके, डिपेंडिंग अपॉन योर जोग्राफिकल कंडीशंस, राइट? सो दैट होल एरिया फ्रॉम विच द रेन वाटर फ्लोज, ओके, द रिवर गेट द वाटर फ्रॉम द रेन, सो दैट रेन वाटर, okay, the area from which the rainwater flows in, okay, it flows into the rivers or it might flows into a tributary, okay, whatever it is. So that whole area, okay, is known as a catchment area, or it is also known as a watershed area. Now each surface reservoir and each body of water has its own catchment area, okay. So that means the watershed are divided into three types, okay, that is, first is geographical, then is rainfed, and the other one is geophysical. Now we know has each surface reservoir and each body of water has its own catchment area. Now they are very small watersheds which come together. Now when they come together, okay, they form a large watersheds, okay, small tiny watersheds, they come together and they form a one large watersheds. Now this large watersheds also, they come together from different places, and when they all come together from different places, many such streams, they form a river valley, okay. Now watershed classification is dependent upon its area. You can see the table over there. Mini watershed is 100 hectares, micro watershed is 500 hectares, sub micro watershed is 2500 hectares, milli watershed is 5000 hectares, then major watershed is 1000 hectares, and drainage basin is approximately up to 1000 hectares. Okay, now the next is the dimensions. Now the dimensions depends on the size of the water, depends upon the size of the catchment area, okay. A large catchment area is beneficial for a drainage system, okay, it is very useful for drainage. Now however, as the catchment area expands, so does there is a variation in its geological composition, then also there is a variation in soil, then the type of soil and the slope. So in this way the watershed area is completely dependent upon the various geographical factors. Next, the size. The size of the catchment area affects the source flowing through the area, flowing through that area. Now it means that the proportion of watershed coming from the catchment area, okay, it is related to the ratio of its length and width. That means it is inversely proportional to the length and it is directly proportional to the width. So if the length of the, for example, if the length of the catchment area is greater than its width, then what happens? It takes a longer time for the water to come out of the catchment area. So if it takes longer time, okay, if it takes longer for the water to come out, then what happens? It allows water to accumulate, okay, it accumulates and it seeps into the soil. So when it seeps into the soil, then a very less amount of water is being released out. But if the same situation is released, that is, if the same situation is reversed, that is, if the width is greater than the length, then what happens? The water in the entire catchment area falls into the source early. So there is more water released out. Therefore, it is less blocked and less seeps into the soil. Okay. Next, the slope. The average slope of a watershed is determined by the height of the highest point in the catchment area and the maximum length of the slope. Okay, how it is calculated? It is calculated, or it is determined by the height of the highest point in the catchment area and the maximum length of the slope. That means the time it takes for a drop of water flowing from the farthest point to reach the source to get out of the catchment area is inversely proportional to the height along the horizontal distance from that root. This means that it takes less time to carry water in a steeply sloping catchment area than in a flat catchment area. So, if it takes longer for the catchment to be carried away, more water it gets seeps into the soil and the catchment is reduced. Next, ground cover. Ground cover is a surface vegetation which affects both the surface watershed and soil erosion. Okay, now what is ground cover? Ground cover means the ground is covered entirely by grass, that is called as a ground cover. So if there is a grass everywhere on the ground, it keeps the soil particles tight, okay, and there is no, or it reduces the chances of soil erosion. Okay, if there is a dense vegetation on the ground, then the intensity of rain falling on the ground is reduced by getting stuck in it, and hence the soil particles will be less blown and the erosion will be less reduced. We know the grass, the roots of the grass or the roots of the trees, they hold the soil, okay, they tighten the soil. So even when there is a rainfall, the water flows, okay, but when it flows, it does not carry the particles of the soil along with it because of the roots of the grass. So that means there are very less chances of soil erosion. But if the land is cultivated and crops are taken, then there is a lot of erosion as the soil particles are free in such land. Okay. Now if it is a cultivated land, or suppose the crops have been cultivated on that land, then what happens? There are chances of soil erosion taking place because the soil particles are free. Okay. So the roots of the plant, they also increase the porosity of the soil. Okay, there are chances that it may increase the porosity. Porosity means there are minute pores in the soil. Okay, so it increases the chances of porosity of the soil. So as a result, more and more water seeps into the soil, and reduces the catchment area. Okay, then next, land use. Now, to study how the land in the catchment area is being used now, or how to use it in the future according to the use of the land, it is important for us to plan the use of watershed area. Then also it is important to plan the infiltration. Now, what is infiltration? It is a process of water entering into the soil to the earth surface. Okay, the water enter into the soil through the earth surface, that is called as infiltration. Okay, it is called as infiltration of the soil. So to determine how to use this, it is important for us to first know how the watershed area is being used, then the process of infiltration and the drainage in this catchment area. Okay, now, next is water infiltration. The water holding capacity and drainage capacity of the soil depends on the amount of water infiltration in it. Okay, so the water holding capacity and drainage capacity of the soil depends upon the water infiltration in it, that is the amount of water the soil holds in it. Okay, if the water holding capacity of the soil is high, okay, it will absorb large portion of rainwater. But due to the lack of natural drainage of water in this soil, there is a risk of infertility due to water. It reduces the fertility of the soil. Now, conversely, in lands with high drainage capacity, maximum water can be absorbed and surface runoff can be reduced. So watershed from land with low water holding and drainage capacity will be more. The next, soil. Now we know soil is the most important factor in the nature. Now the water holding capacity, drainage and inflow of soils depend upon it. Okay, this means the amount of watershed and erosion depends on it for a large extent. For this, the type of soil has to be decided by studying the composition, texture, color, etc. of the soil. Okay. Next, geological components. And geological components, the type of soil depends on the subsoil. Okay. It depends upon the subsoil and also it depends upon the rock. Okay. Now, the type of soil depends on the subsoil and the rock. Now, soil depth is also a factor affecting the soil erosion and it also affects water sheds. Next, rainfall. Now, rainfall is the largest and the most important factor determining the amount of watershed and soil erosion. Okay. Now, so it is simply impossible to plan watershed management without studying the rainfall in the catchment area. Many of the properties of rainfall affect the extent of the watershed and the erosion of the soil in different ways. Now, rainfall is the rainwater falling on the surface, right? It is measured in millimeters. The amount of rainwater that falls on a given surface area over a period of time is considered to be the rainfall over that area over a period of time. The water measured in this way up to a given date throughout the year is accumulated rainfall up to that date. And the total rainfall of such major rain throughout the year is considered as annual rainfall of that area. Okay, so how it is being measured? It is measured upon depending upon the period of time over that particular area. Okay, so how much water is being accumulated with the rainfall up to that date and the total rainfall of such major rain throughout the year. So how much it rains throughout the year in that particular area, okay, it helps to consider the annual rainfall of that particular area. Thus, the average annual rainfall of the area is determined by averaging the rainfall over the past few years. They can take a average rainfall by taking the rainfall of 2 years or might be 3 years or might be 10 years depending upon the rainfall it happened for those particular years. This rainfall determines the total watershed of a catchment area. Now, we know rain does not usually fall continuously, right? But sometimes stop falling and then starts falling again after some time. The period of time when rain falls at one time is called as a rainy season. You all know in India we have a climates, okay, we have seasons, okay, rainy, winter, then summer, right? So in India, especially in Maharashtra, the rain falls only during rainy season. Okay, so this period of time when the rain falls, okay, is called as rainy season. If the rainfall in this season is short, maximum water is absorbed into the soil, okay, and the amount of the surface runoff decreases. But if the rainfall in this season is high, then what happens? The land becomes saturated, okay, the land becomes saturated and there is no water holding capacity left over for the soil. So what happens? There is more runoff. Okay, then rainfall density. Rainfall density is the amount of rain that falls over a period of time. It is usually calculated in millimeters per hour. The rainfall in a given hour is the density of that rainfall in that hour. Okay. Rain does not fall uniformly throughout that region. The rainfall distribution depends on the area in which it falls and the period in which it falls. Okay, that means the rain, the hour in which the maximum rainfall density is found throughout the year is considered to be the maximum rainfall density of that catchment area for that year. So now, considering the rainfall density of the last few years, we will consider which is the highest. Okay, now if the rainfall is highest in that particular year, then we call that as a rainfall density. Okay, then next, groundwater. Okay, now groundwater is a water beneath the land, okay, which is inside the land. It can be in a porous soil, or it can be in a rocky crevices, or in a cavity of the soil. Now, the chemical composition of this water is simple, easy, and plain. Now, most of the water is trapped in the rocks and sometimes very deep into the ground. It is free from turbidity, offensive color, or harmful microorganisms, so it doesn't need much processing to use it properly. Now, this water is again relatively much safer than surface water, okay, because it is safe from chemical, radioactive, and biological pollution. Then next, since this water is underground, it is not affected much by any kind of climatic change or even drought. Even this water is generally available locally. The means of supply may be available at cheaper rates. So this water is also economically beneficial. Okay, next, the groundwater sources. First one is rainfall. Now this is a source of water. Rainfall is the main source of water. Rain, snow, or water seeps underground from the earth's surface. Now this amount of water that accumulates in the area depends upon the types of rocks in that area and the characteristics of characteristics of that area means the quality of the soil, the type of the soil, then the characteristics of the rocks. Okay, it all depends upon this characteristics. Normally where there are sedimentary rocks, the infiltration rate is higher. That is, the infiltration rate means the water holding capacity, that is the process in which the water enters the soil, okay, it is higher. This is because these rocks have most cavity, okay, they are very small cavities inside the rock. So what happened, the water can get absorbed into this rocks. Now along with rain and snow, rivers and lake can also be the source of this water. Now if the porosity of the soil and rocks is high, then what happens, the underground water table is above a water current. Okay, for example, suppose two water currents are at more and less height from each other, and if the porosity of the rocks is high, then what happens, the water will seep from high current into a low current. Okay, then next, conduit water. Now this conduit water does not seep into the soil from the surface. The water gets stuck in between the sedimentary rocks. Okay, so this water gets stuck in the sedimentary rocks is called as conduit water. Okay, you can see the figure over here, how the water is between the rocks. And next, magma or volcanic water. When water vapor in the molten rocks is formed due to the underground magma, okay, then what happens, it rises through the available notches. If it does not find a place to rise, okay, now if suppose it does not find any place to come out, what happens, it eventually condenses and transforms into water. This is called as volcanic water. Okay, now groundwater again returns to the surface in the following ways. The first one is water in the nearby reservoirs, that is example rivers, lakes, ponds, etc. It can come again into this form, okay, from these resources. Now, as the groundwater travels from the hill, okay, according to the law of gravity, it is found to flow out in the form of springs in the mountainous areas where it penetrates the surfaces. Now also it is extracted for the use from wells. Next, now the groundwater is classified into the following parts. First one is aquifer. Okay, now what is aquifer? It is a body of rocks that holds the groundwater. It has the capacity to hold groundwater. The body of rocks has the capacity. Let's study more. Aquifer is made up of soil, then it is made up of sandy soil, mud, crack rocks, limestone, etc. Okay. Now this area have hollow spaces that can be connected to each other. Now the water can seep easily into this because they have spaces in between. That means the velocity of groundwater seeping through depends on the size of the cavities in the soil and how they are connected to each other. So it's the main feature is that the reservoir can store water as well as supply water due to its permeability. Okay. Now again they are classified into two types, okay, depending upon the location of the ground. First is unconfined aquifer and the second one is confined aquifer. Now what is unconfined aquifer? Unconfined aquifer is, it means that water seeps from the ground surface directly above the aquifer. Okay, and confined aquifer means it prevents water from seeping. Okay, here it seeps directly, here it prevents the water from seeping. So let's study first unconfined aquifer. The soil and the rock pores in this area contain air as well as water. Now being close to the surface, it is affected by the atmospheric pressure. Where there is a lake as well as a swamp, this part does not exist, but in the desert region it covers 100 of meters. Now groundwater plays a very important role in providing us the various nutrients and water for all living creatures. So now let's see the characteristics of unconfined aquifer. This unsaturated aquifer controls the flow of water from the surface to the saturated aquifer. Okay, unsaturated aquifer means there are pockets of air which contains water in it. Okay, there are rocks, okay, which have pockets of air. Now what happens, the water enters into this rocks, okay, so the air which is there, it absorbs the water. So the water this unsaturated aquifer controls the flow of water from the surface to the saturated aquifer. Then next, it also affects the recharge of aquifer. It is crucial in groundwater use and management. It also helps in removing the unwanted substances. The next one is confined aquifer. Okay, confined aquifer means they are impermeable rocks that exist, okay, but it helps in preventing the water from seeping. Now the layer of saturated aquifer is below the unsaturated level. Similarly, gaps between these cracked rocks and other gaps, okay, similarly there are gaps between these rocks, okay, now and all these gaps are filled with water. Now since there are many layers on the saturated layer, the layer is detached from the surface, or it is also detached from the atmosphere. Next, fountain well. If water comes to the surface due to natural pressure after digging a well, then that well is called as a fountain well. Now fountain well means you know the well, okay, a pond or a well, okay, it is an example of a fountain well. What happens, we dig the well, so what happens is a natural pressure after digging, okay, so when the water level rise up, okay, that well is called as a fountain well. Now what happens if the water is pumped out of the well from different water holding layers? Now when the water is pumped out of unsaturated aquifer, the water level decreases and the water in the empty spaces decreases. Whereas when the water is pumped out of a saturated reservoirs, the water pressure decreases but the spaces remain filled with water. Next is aquitard. You know the water is not available everywhere, okay, due to its low permeability, right? But if there is a reservoir below this layer, the water in it seeps into the reservoir. Now sandy soil is an example, okay. Next, aquiclude. Now as this layer is porous, it has a good water holding capacity but it does not seep the water, therefore the water is not available from it, okay. The best example of it is the clay. It is moist, it is porous, but it does not seep, but the water does not seep into it. It has a good water holding capacity. Next, aquifuge. Now this layer is impermeable. Impermeable means it does not allow fluid to pass by, okay, and not porous. It does not have minute pores, neither it allow the fluid to pass by, therefore it cannot hold water and water does not seep through it, okay. Why? Because it does not have pores to catch hold of water from where the water can pass by, neither do it allow fluids to pass by, so there is no point of water passing through it or water holding it. So the best example of this is a hard rock, okay. Hard rock is a example of this. Then hanging aquifer. This layer is on the top of unsaturated level, okay. Now its size is generally small. The amount of water depends on the weather condition. Next, surface water. Now we know surface water is found everywhere on the surface. It includes rivers, lakes, springs, reservoirs, ponds, etc. Although we know sea water is salty, it is still surface water, right? We cannot use it, but still we consider it as a surface water. Now, the surface water is divided into three types. First is a perennial, second is temporary, and third one is man-made. Now, perennial water. Perennial surface water means it has water throughout the year. Okay. If the rainfall is low, it can be recharged by groundwater. The water level can be recharged easily with the help of groundwater. That is called as a perennial. That means it has water throughout the year. You can see the picture over there. Then temporary water means it contains water only for a few months in that particular year. Okay, this include coastal creeks. The next is man-made. Man-made means water from dams as well as constructed catchment areas, ponds, wells, all these are related to man-made surface water. Okay. Next, distribution of water. Now, how the water has been distributed on the earth. Now, you can see the figure over there. Earth's total water is how much, you can see, okay. Now from 100, in the first figure you can see 97% water is brackish water. Brackish water means sea water, salty water. Only 3% is fresh water, okay. Now the second part of the figure says that from that 3% of fresh water, okay, 30% is groundwater and remaining 69% is in the form of icebergs or it is in the form of glaciers. From that 3% I'm talking about, okay. Already 97% is seawater, 3% is drinking water or fresh water. Now out of that fresh water, out of that 3%, 30% is only groundwater and remaining 69 is in the form of ice or in the form of glacier river, and remaining 1% can be in any other form. Now, out of that 30%, okay, 87% water is in the form of pond water, 2% is in the form of rivers, and 11% is wetland. Okay, so that means it says that much of the fresh water is in the form of snow and ice, okay, and the rest is in the consist of rivers, lakes, groundwater and air vapor. So it means that even though the amount of water in the earth on the earth is high, the usable water is much less than 1%. So you all can see how important it is for us to save the water and to use proper or to manage proper water use. Okay, thank you. Now, for your homework, you have to do the exercise which is there after the chapter. You have to write all the questions. Okay, only question number 13 you don't have to do. Rest all of the other questions from question number 1 to 12 you have to do for your homework in your notebook itself. Okay, thank you.